Live in Washington, the Robert Christian Show. Visit us on the web at robertchristianshow.com. Everybody enjoys a .com. If you don't have a .com, maybe you should have a .com. Hey, folks, that's a little bit loaded, and this is the second hour of the Robert Christian Show, and we are talking today, ladies and gentlemen, with our featured guest, Michael Cagle. There is more to Michael than what meets the eye. There is, and a lot of our viewers, a lot of our fans, they know Michael's music because, well, every now and then I play some of Michael's tunes, and people enjoy that. I think it is outstanding. He is an outstanding singer, but beyond the scope of music, we're talking about a lot of things. We've been talking about politics, the political arena, and it really is, if we want to agree or not, but it has turned into a clown car. It's turned into a circus, a three-ring circus. When will the end come? And then we see the uprising, the evils of bigotry and hatred in America, insomuch that even a nightclub in Orlando, Florida was shot up by one lone wolf gunman that had some issues. And then we have, okay, and now comes the icing on the birthday cake. Are you all ready for this? Our beloved Democrats on the Senate floor set in, and they were there 25 hours saying no bill, no break. They did not want to break. They wanted to continue on, and they did for 25 hours. Nonetheless, Paul Ryan shut them down, or at least he attempted to, so much that even C-SPAN, the premier network that airs Congress, the congressional floor, the Senate floor, they turned their cameras off and powered off their mics in his own protest. Now, mind you, this is the third leading officer in American politics, right? You've got the president, vice president, and the speaker of the House. Well, here he is. He shut it all down. Lo and behold, and to his dismay, we find that these Democrats, these lawmakers, were piping up with their cell phones and turning on the YouTube, turning on the Periscope, turning on the Facebook, and going live on these other platforms to get the word out, so the American populace would continue to have the right to know what's going on. And I salute them for that. Now, that is the tip of the iceberg. Now we have to get into the iceberg. The hatred in America. Michael, welcome back to the show. And I hope
that very good. Yes.
I hope that you can stay on for the next hour.
I watched the sit-in with...
Wait. Hold on a second, Michael. Can you stay for the next hour of the show? It's a two-hour show.
You got me.
Okay, we got him. Great. Hey, and everybody is like, whoop, whoop, whoop. Go, Robert. Go, Michael. Okay, Michael, go ahead.
Here's the thing. Mm-hmm. I want to say this because I don't dislike every Republican. I want people to know that. Okay? There are logical, realistic, moderate Republicans out there. They're a dying breed, or maybe they're just completely quiet because we're mesmerized by the Looney Tunes and the clown cars.
Yes.
But, there are Republicans that I know that maybe don't agree with Democrats fiscally, but they're not, what I'm saying? So I don't want to accuse anybody of thinking that me or you are just complete one-sided. Oh, just because, I'm a progressive. That's what I am. I'm a progressive liberal. I'm proud of that title. I love it. I believe that I believe in capitalism. I believe in making money.
Mm-hmm.
But I believe it should never come at the expense of your fellow citizen. I don't believe that the United States, as a country, we are better than allowing people to be bigoted or prejudiced because they happen to be black or Hispanic or gay or old, you know, whatever the case may be. I believe that we are entitled to health care. I that's crazy. I know. And everybody, you know, here's the thing. Everybody goes to the extreme on their argument. Like, I remember when they were talking about a year ago, if the Supreme Court allows gays to marry, then oh my God, what's next? Barn animals. First of all, if in your head you can equate two human beings getting married and having sex being the same as a man and a barn animal, then the issue's you, not because that's really weird to me. But everybody always goes to the extreme. And it's like, don't be the extreme. Do things common sense. You know, if the same thing happens with a gun issue, which is what happened on the floor of the House of Representatives. It was like the moment, and there are people that I know that are Democrats that are pro-gun Democrats. They're pro-Second Amendment. I want to say this up front. I don't hate guns. I would own a gun. I used to own a gun. I would own another gun. But I would be responsible. You know, it's like the moment you start saying things like background checks or responsibility, everybody freaks out and goes, and here, once again, they go to the absurd. They're coming for our guns. Where in the statement that there should be proper background checks, and if you're not allowed to fly in an airplane, you shouldn't be able to buy a gun? That's just stupid, idiot stuff. How mm-hmm. can you say that? How can you compare logic, common sense logic, like that, and then all of a sudden say, well, if we allow that, then all of a sudden they're going to come for our guns, and Obama wants your guns, or Clinton wants your guns, and Sanders wants your guns, or whoever wants your guns? No. We want responsible gun legislation.
You know? Absolutely, Michael. We do. We see already the ills of it. Now, folks, let's compare. Now, when I do this, when I show you this extremely ill comparison, we're going to find a central truth. Here it goes. And people, they're going to celebrate it. And then again, people are going to say, no. Robert, now I don't like you. Well, tough. The truth of it is, Michael, I like the European model of gun ownership. And they go, oh my God, people in Europe, they can't own a gun. Look at it. Actually, they can. However, and this is the however, and this is written into their law when it comes to gun ownership, that you can't have it on your person, you can't have it in your car, and you can't have it at your home. Where is it then, Robert? I'm glad you asked. It is in a safe lockbox. It is in a gun range that is owned and operated by the British government. That is where it is. So if you want to fire your gun, no problem. You go to a gun range. You're not going to have free willy-nilly out and about carrying a gun on your person. And guess what? Their crime rate is much lower than it is in the United States. Their domestic violence rates are much lower than what it is in the United States. The act of terrorism by a lone gunman, like what happened in Orlando, in England, it is virtually non-existent. The police departments, very few have a gun. This is why. They say because if you want to get the attention of the bad guy, guess what? Even over there, the bad guys don't get guns. I'm sure that some have them, but they would be arrested on the spot if they were found to have a gun. So therefore, very few police officers have them. Some do, not all. So, Michael, their big thing, as it always has been, the funny-looking hats that look like, well, whatever, these animals, these varmints, right? They have these tall hats, and they have their stick, their billy club thing. And trust me, they know how to use them. I watched protests live in London. And the police department there, Michael, it was absolutely insane. The police department, rather than telling people, if you don't get the hell out of here, you're going to be arrested. You know, hey, I've got the gun, I've got the pepper spray, I've got the baton, I've got all these things to take you down and take you out. They were like, no, if you're disabled, let us know and we'll walk you to where you need to go so you'll be in a safe area. They were absolutely genuinely nice about it, Michael. So we see the niceness of it in a society that at least on the surface appears to be somewhat safer than that of the United States. But Michael, you bring up the issue of common sense. Now I ask you, your opinion, your thought. When and where did America lose their common sense? That's loaded, I know it is, but go for it. Hey, I ask the hard questions that a lot of people would never have
Well, you know.
Come on, you can come up with something.
In what respect? I mean, oh my God.
Did it ever have common sense?
Well, you know, I think it has. I think there has. I don't think common sense necessarily is equated or attached entirely to being incredibly smart, because I know people that aren't book smart that are high in common sense. That's a tough question. I wasn't ready for that one.
That is a hard question.
Because I think people have high common sense until it gets to something that is personal to them. And then I think they lose their mind.
Well, Michael, if I were to answer that question...
Okay. Same kind of concept. I know people that are very smart, but because of their religious upbringing... When this whole debate about same-sex marriage, you know, a year ago to the day, pretty much, people that were common, that I would consider smart, would, because of their religious beliefs, would say things that were so astronomically crazy, but in their head... That's immediately where they went. And I think common sense means that you literally go to a place of defense and protection and fear. I think fear is an opposite of common sense, because if you talk to somebody, like I said, I have friends that are Democrats, that if I start talking gun control, they immediately say, nobody's taking my guns. And I'm like, where did that come from? Where did the words, the government wants your guns, or even my belief, I believe you shouldn't have guns. I never said that. Not even my post, because I'm kind of political on Facebook. I write, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on and I say what I feel. And I will write stuff like, right off the bat, I'm a pro-gun advocate, I believe in common sense regulation and common sense ownership. I do believe that weapons like the AR-15 don't belong in the hands of just anybody, if anybody, because you're not going to use it to hunt. You would rip apart whatever animal you were going to hunt. I mean, it's designed to be a semi-rapid-fire weapon of war. So, unless you're planning on that, why would you own it? So I don't understand the comprehension of that. But that doesn't mean that I will come and take your hunting rifle, or I don't think that you should have a handgun, or that you shouldn't have the right to protect your house, quote unquote. What I'm saying is, if you're a law-abiding, sane person that would have no issue passing a background check, and you would have no issue in your life that would prevent you from owning a gun, why are you scared of enforcing rules to make sure that everyone that has a gun is the same way? Because all that would do would mean the people that would be targeted to lose their guns are the people that shouldn't have them anyway. If I was on a Robert, if I was on a playground,
mm-hmm.
and I was a teacher, and a kid was beating the other kids with a stick, I would not equip all the other kids with sticks
mm-hmm.
to take care of the situation. I would remove the stick from the kid that shouldn't have had one. And the philosophy of gun owners is, we don't want common sense background check. We want to give sticks to all the kids on the playground.
Mm-hmm.
Really? That it doesn't make any sense. Why?
Right.
Equip everybody. Don't put limitations on anybody. There's a drunk driving epidemic.
Yes.
Do we limit the alcohol that the person consuming alcohol is allowed to drink, or do we just allow everybody in the bar to drink more?
Well, Michael, if I were to answer the same question, you know, at what point in time did America lose its common sense? I would have to say this: hook, line, and sinker. The moment in history where America got away from it, from the founding fathers' visions and their ideas, and where politics became a money making scheme, a like a Ponzi scheme, and where they were being bought off by the NRA, when they were being bought off by maybe the Koch brothers, when they were being bought off by the pharmaceutical giants, and they got away with it. When America stepped back from its fundamental values that all men were created equal, that is where, and the point in history. And folks, that's a big pill to swallow, but I hope that you don't choke on it.
Yeah.
Michael, you know, it is devastating. Now we see the anger in the streets, and of course, as I have said before, on live shows, that come November and come January, we are going to see an absolute uprising, I believe, in America, like we've never seen before, and it's not necessarily going to be good. But there is so much anger that is going on, and we could talk about the mental issues of the anger and all this stuff. But realistically, folks, we need to be looking at gun control for what it is. Let's not add any more fuel to the fire. The fire is already hot enough. What we need is somebody with a cool mind, a cool temperance, to be able to say, you know what? Maybe these guns are not the best things. If we ban all of them, that's still not going against the Second Amendment right. If you ban the AR-15 and just the AR-15, or maybe a handful of other guns,
right? High capacity magazines, or
you got it.
Because look, the founding fathers knew that the Constitution was going to eventually continue to grow. There are people that believe that like Scalia, who I think was ridiculous, believed that the Constitution was a non-living, black and white, needed to be interpreted strictly for what it was. There were no amendments. It was a perfect piece of legislation. Then there are people who believe that the Constitution is a set of guidelines that the forefathers obviously were not psychic. They didn't know 200 years from the time they signed it what the United States would look like, what we were dealing with, what kind of issue. So therefore, they allowed amendments. You know, even the Second Amendment was an amendment. It wasn't right. included. So that Second Amendment meant, you know, just the fact that they included a Second Amendment allows you to realize that they knew that the Constitution was going to change, that there were going to be, you know, black men are not 3/5 a person. That needed to be changed. Women have the right to vote. They didn't. They were property
right.
at the time that the Constitution
That's right.
was written. You know, so just like, quote, if you're a religious person, the Bible is not a literal translation, you know, because as much as people want to say, oh, the Bible says that gay people are going to hell in certain scriptures, so does eating shellfish and wearing polyester. And if you're left-handed, you know, if you're left-handed, you're mentioned 10 times more in the Bible going to hell than being gay. So it doesn't make any sense. But the Constitution, to me, is a living, breathing document because it's able to change with the times. And we don't have muskets anymore. And we're not creating a militia out of our household. You know, it was designed for the militia. And it's even in the Second Amendment as that. In order to create an effective militia, we don't need a militia at our house. We have the Army, Navy, Marines, blah, 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 blah. So if you're going to literally understand what the Second Amendment is, it wasn't that anybody, regardless of their mental state, has the right to own a gun, putting in jeopardy every single person around them, and he has the right to buy any gun.
Correct. But I don't see, Michael, that many Americans, wink, wink, America, I don't see that many Americans that are buying army tanks.
Army tanks?
Yeah, why not?
They're expensive.
I mean, that's a piss poor excuse, because if your mindset and your heartstrings are to go and blow a place up, go, no matter how many people are in there, maybe you feel the more the merrier, all right? And you've got this idea. Why not just duel with an army tank and one blow and that's it, and that's the end of the story, end of the whole city block. But right. They're like, oh, no, I'll go with my Pete. I'll tell you a funny little story, Michael. My mother, love her to death, she used to live in upstate Idaho and out in the beautiful country. Gorgeous country, but she lived out there, and I remember going out her back door. It took my stepfather about a half an hour. Now, mind you, this is how the Civil War was won. All right, it wasn't with these machine guns and AR-15s and BB guns and no, the black powdered shotgun. I went out there. Shall I say any more? I went out there. There was a target on the ground out there, and there were two loads in the gun. You know, half an hour in between me, I shot one of them, and this girl, this female that my mother and stepfather back in the day that they knew, and so they said, put it up to your shoulder real strong. You know, well, I did. I tell you what, Michael. That one gun knocked me flat on my butt. And seriously, and I missed the target by mere inches.
Wow.
She got the same gun. It was loaded up once again for her, and she shot it. She stayed on her feet, and she nailed the target. Wow. Now, that's how, and those things, talking about a kick and talking about noise, they make noise. But speaking of noise, though, Michael, I think that was actually the last time I shot a rifle was back then. But I think that America, that we need to get back to a central core value system rather than just focusing all of our attention. If you're a Republican, stop focusing 100% of your attention on the Second Amendment right. They kept saying, Michael, that Hillary and Bernie, they want to come and get your gun. No.
But they never said that. See, that's a weird right. thing about it.
They never did.
Right. Just because someone enforces stiffer drunk driving laws doesn't mean they're coming after our cars.
Right.
Or our alcohol. It means if you're going to partake of alcohol, there's a responsibility. If you're going to drive a vehicle, you have a certain responsibility. If you own a car, you have to register your car. You have to pass a driver's test to operate a vehicle. You can't, as common sense America all wanting to live, you don't want to know. I would want to know that if my neighbor next door had a gun, that he was able to pass the requirements to own one. Right. I would knock on his door and say, hey, I want your gun. I don't like your guns. I would actually be glad that it was registered or that he passed a background check so that if I see him on the street, because in some states you're allowed to carry open carry.
Yes.
Then there are some states that if you feel threatened, the stand your ground law, all you have to do is feel threatened and you could kill somebody. So
right,
my
right.
question is, what happens when the two meet? What happens when the open carry state meets the stand your ground state? And what happens? Then you'll see a real fight. Then you will know the racial inequality. Because
it's the wild, wild west, Michael, all right, over again.
If you walk into your listeners and your viewers, if you were walking into a restaurant and you saw a group of white males with guns, or you walked in the same restaurant and saw a group of black men with guns, who would you be more scared of?
Ouch. Good question. Hey, Michael, let's take the bottom of the hour break. We're going to be back. Because you know what, Michael? If people want to believe it or not, folks, hey, here is a coinciding for you. When it comes to gun violence, that there are more white or Caucasian young men that are found with guns and perpetrating crimes with guns than black men. Go figure. I'm Robert Christian. Thank you. Live from Washington, the Robert Christian Show. On the web, robertchristianshow.com. Hey, we are happy to have you joining us today for this edition of the Robert Christian Show. And by the way, before I forget, you know, I almost did forget. But I am getting ready to take off the first 2 weeks for my summer break. And the show, the Robert Christian Show, will not be back on until, let me look, where's my drum roll sound effect? Not until September. Just kidding. Don't get excited. It'll be July the 15th will be the next live show that I do. It's going to be fantastic. My partner and I, we are soon to be celebrating 22 years this upcoming July 4th. So that's going to be an incredible day in history, I think, for us. When we were told, Michael, guess what? You guys will not even last 6 months. Well, that's been 22 years ago. So, Michael, we are back with you. That's been a long time. So I know, Michael, that when it comes to gun violence, that yes, something does need to be done about it. It's no brainstorm, but the Republicans, or at least a lot of them, have argued the point. They have blocked everything that they can possibly block to prevent gun legislation and gun laws being passed, if it is bipartisan or not. They still reject it. And
well,
I find it odd.
Well, my issue is that they know they're on the losing end.
Yes.
89% of Americans, all Americans, not Democrats, not Republicans, we're talking general, 89% believe in cutting the gun show loopholes, looking for background checks, making sure that if there's an issue of domestic violence or if they've been on the terror watch list and haven't been taken off, that they shouldn't be able to buy one. 89%. You can't get 89% of the people to agree that the sky is blue. And yet, now, still, even to this day, as divided as we are in our political system, 89% believe in common sense gun legislation. I don't understand what the argument is. The problem is that the NRA is an organization that doesn't make money off of membership. People think, it's not membership. They make shit on membership. Pardon my French.
Well, Michael, were you a member?
They make it on gun sales.
Were you a member of the NRA?
No, I wouldn't be.
Why?
Because they make money based solely off of gun sales. And because of that, they can't effectively even have the right to orchestrate gun laws, because since they only exist and their profit margin only exists every time someone buys a gun. That's how they make their money. So it's the same thing as the oil lobby creating pollution, clean air. They shouldn't be writing laws because they're going to benefit from them. They're going to create the laws that allow them to make the most profit. They don't care about air or climate change or health issues, and the NRA does not care about the health and welfare of Americans. They are interested in getting as many guns in the hands of Americans because that's how they make their profit. That is what they are created to do. They are no different than Ford Motor Company or General Motors, they are selling a product. And if they get their product in the hands of Americans, they make money. End of conversation. So I totally disagree with their entire philosophy.
Well, I think, you know, again, the NRA, they have the right to, and I'm not going to say, I'm not going to stretch it and say they have a constitutional right, but they have a right as a business to be a business in the United States.
They honestly do, but for them to say that they care, they don't. Because nowhere else, in no other situation would you say the only thing they can stop a bad guy with a gun is a good guy with a gun. No, and only right. in America at this time could we ever, like I said, go back to being the teacher on the schoolyard. Seeing a kid beating kids with a stick, do you, as the responsible adult in the room or in the playground, take the stick away and say, no, you're not allowed to play with this. This is not what it was intended for. You don't have the responsibility to have that stick in your hand. Or do you go, hey, we need to equip all the kids with sticks and then see what happens? Because the only one that can take out a bad kid with a stick is a schoolyard full of bad kids with sticks. Really?
Well,
okay. Honestly, come on.
Okay, well, Michael, let's look at this. All right. Now, I've got to poke fun at this. I do. Come on, folks. Give me a break. I can poke fun at this. At least one thing, right? The Republicans are saying no, absolutely no to gun control or to gun control legislation of any kind. No, we're not going to do this. Okay, wait a second. Then if that's the case, then why are there metal detectors at the NRA meetings or at the Republican conventions that are going around, the political stumps of these Republican figures, i.e. Donald Trump, why then are they saying, oh, if you have a weapon, why they're going to confiscate it or you can't come in with it? That is gun regulation. So they can't have it both ways. Michael, enlighten me.
Oh, no, I agree. I think it's absolutely... Can I swear?
You already have.
I was going to drop the F-bomb, but I guess I won't.
Not that word.
I agree with that. I've been on my best behavior.
Oh, he has, trust me.
I have been. Okay. Being completely honest.
Yeah.
Watching this huge debate about... And I lived almost 2 years in Tennessee.
I'm so sorry. And, well, I did too, but anyway, go ahead.
Okay, so, and they're big, you know, they're big pro-gun people, blah, blah, blah. And they were having this big Republican event, and they had just passed the right to carry anywhere kind of law, basically. I mean, basically, you can carry it into church if you want. Okay. Except when they had the NRA's gun... meeting. They had, you know, the French twit that owned, you know, the president or whatever his name is. I can't remember. But he was going to be there and all these other people. We're not going to allow you to bring your guns into this event, though. You can bring it into the schools and the theaters and classrooms and churches and parks.
Mm-hmm.
But we can't let you bring it into our NRA event. Really?
So, really? Yeah, that's what I'm saying, Michael. Really? So is that being bigoted?
Hypocritical?
Yeah.
Hypocritical? What are they afraid of? Too many bad guys with a gun? Not enough good guys with a gun? Really? The bottom line is, if you recognize the potential for the threat of violence in an event in which you're trying to sanction every other person should have it, but you don't allow it, It's hypocritical.
Well, Michael, you know what? Donald Trump, he has this idea that you give more people guns, the less violence will happen. Well,
okay,
Michael, I asked this question and think about it long and hard for about 8 seconds. But this is it. Since when do you call a fire department and they come put out your house fire with fire? When do they do that, Michael?
They don't. No, they don't. But you know what? Here's the thing.
You're right. You're right. But why not? No, I mean, that's his logic.
And you don't combat drunk drivers by putting more of them on the road.
Correct. Okay, so I agree. Now, where is this logic? I mean, besides
But it's because, look, it's because people fear, once people fear, and we talked about this common sense earlier.
Hmm. Whatever that is. But
the key to common sense is removing fear.
Yes.
The less fearful you are, the more logical and common sense you're going to be, because you're going to go, oh, okay, I understand what's going on. But our national reaction is going to be, oh my, what? Two guys getting married and they're going to live next door to me. What'd they say? It's going to ruin the foundation of marriage.
There goes the neighborhood.
What? Okay. Two guys marrying.
Right.
Is going to ruin the foundation of marriage. I don't understand but that's where they skewed. All of a sudden, this unrational fear comes in, and all of a sudden, common sense is gone. It's like, I remember everybody saying, if we allow the gays to marry, we're going to crumble as a nation. Really? Honest?
Well,
really?
Yeah.
Honest?
Right.
That you think that's going? You think the fact that me and my husband, we have that much power in the universe by uniting our souls together, we're going to have that kind of cataclysmic reaction? Really? Honest? It's just like,
okay. Well,
the
Michael,
rationale is gone.
All right, I've got to be nosy. Let folks, I'm going to get nosy with Michael. Ooh, and we're going to find out really what goes on in the bedroom. Michael, here's a good question for you, and I've waited a year to ask this.
And I hate Trump. Okay, go ahead.
Well, I'm not a Trumper either, you know, or Trumpet. A Trumper,
I
or Trumpet.
I think he's exactly what he is, Frankenstein's monster.
But maybe his twin brother. But let me ask you, let me ask you this though, Michael. Year in the making.
You're going to ask me about my bedroom?
Yeah. A year in the making, because you and your partner now have celebrated, or soon to celebrate. No, you already have, haven't you?
July 25th.
Your first year anniversary. Okay.
July 25th.
How has the community at large, both of them, the heterosexual, the boring community, or the gay community, which at times can be a little hostile, okay, but how have they accepted and adapted to you and your marriage?
Wow.
Have they been accepting?
I would say yes, but I've never really cared. I wouldn't care regardless. My husband is very, very much a homebody. When we go out, he likes to stay. He basically likes to stay home, but we go out and do stuff. I'm usually the social butterfly. I'm usually the one that's mingling and everything. I'm the kind of person that would hold his hand regardless of wherever we were at. Not to make a statement, but if I do, that's even better. But it's because it's how I feel. He's a little bit more reserved. It depends. He doesn't want, it's not that he's embarrassed or ashamed. He just doesn't want to create a scene that isn't necessarily there. or he does that he doesn't want to be there, I guess you'd say. But
well, have you found acceptance within your peers?
You know, it's really kind of cool because my husband's family is very religious. I'll leave it at that. And they came to the wedding, and I think it was very vitally important. We've been together for a long, long time, and we just got married a year ago. But we didn't want to have a civil union. We didn't want to have a gay marriage. We wanted to have a marriage. If somebody says, "Are you gay married? You know, did you have a same sex marriage?" We're the same sex, but yes, we got married. There is no difference in my marriage than a heterosexual marriage. I'm married. Mm-hmm. It's marriage is marriage to me. So the really cool thing about it is that we waited until it was legal. And even with his family, who has always treated me really well, we've been together for a long, long time. But the way they perceive us now isn't kind of a fringe couple or fringe marriage. They realize this is a real marriage. You know, I'm his husband, he's mine. I went to an event and his nieces and nephews called me uncle for the first time. And that was very overwhelming for me. That was very emotional for me because it said to me they have accepted what it is. And it's like they couldn't deny it. And because I'm married to him, I am officially their uncle. They had never said that before. The gay community, you know, let's be honest, Robert. The gay community, if you're not under 25 and ripped, you're passe anyway. So it doesn't really matter. You know, it's like, and it hurts for me because I see the gay community has fought for acceptance so much. You know, we're not second class citizens. We want the right to marry. We want the right to love who we love. We don't want to be looked down upon. But yet, in our own community, we do this to people on a regular basis. Oh, that person's not, you know, because, look, I'm over the age of 30. And I'm far from being ripped. You know, I'm chubby. Whatever terminology, you know, and over 30, overweight, you're horrible. And yet I'm like, where did this come from? We have fought so hard to be a family and to be accepted that all of a sudden now, you know, we're passe, you know. And it's so funny, you walk by and you see people just kind of sneering, and I don't think they're sneering because we're married. You know, they're sneering because, you know, all of a sudden they don't realize that, guess what? They're not always going to be 22 and hot. You know, they're going to be 35. Oh, my God, someday they may actually hit 40. You know, it's weird to me. But I can tell you that we've been together for a long, long time, and I didn't think getting married would feel different, but it really does. It really feels there's a connection there. It's fun to say to somebody, this is my husband.
Well, I tell you what, Michael, we're at the end of the show. You know what? It's an hour flies by, 2 hours flies by. You know, it really does. Michael, there is so much more that I would love to dive into and get in with you with. But we want to have you back on the show again. I think it's fantastic. You've got a lot to say, and you are very inspirational.
I hope so. You know, I love this country, and I do love the direction and the enthusiasm that I see happening. But we have a long way to go. And the worst thing that we can do as Americans, as part of the LGBT community, is to say we're satisfied.
Right.
Because we can be better. We can be a better society. We can be a better community. So, yeah.
You know, I completely agree with you. We can. But you know what? That better community starts with you and me.
It does. And I try to. You know, I'm one of these people that I always try to reach my hand out. I always try to say hi to someone. If someone's talking about someone, I don't take it to heart until I get to know the person. You know, there are just things, and I treat people honestly the way I would want to be treated. I would want somebody to come up to me and respect me for me and want to know me for me and to value me based on my character and my integrity and not just off of what they immediately see.
Absolutely. Hey, Michael, hang on the line if you can, and we can chit-chat for a couple right after the show ends.
Enjoy your vacation.
Hey.
Happy anniversary.
Thank you very much. 22 years in the making. But, hey, hang on a second, Michael, and we'll
bye, everybody.
We'll be able to visit off the air. Folks, Michael Cagle, a great guy, great musician, and a funny guy.
I didn't
sing
once.
Say again?
I didn't even sing.
No, actually, you know what? I've got you, Michael, in the background. Here we are, folks. Michael is going to carry us out for the remainder of the show. But, ladies and gentlemen, once again, I want to thank you all for tuning in to the live show, because it's people like you that make doing the show make it worth it. And I enjoy it. And Michael Cagle, he's on Facebook for those of you who don't know who he is. Yeah, you can find him on Facebook. You can also find him at a venue maybe near you. Actually, he's been doing some music, singing, all right, in Seattle. He's done it here. He's done it in, oh my goodness gracious, Las Vegas, Nashville. I'm trying to remember all the little places that he's told me about. I'm trying, you know, I can't expect too much from, anyway. My head just, you know what, I just have so much going on in my head. If you only knew, and that's dangerous. That's dangerous. Anyway, folks, hey, reminding everybody that we are going to be off the air for the next 2 weeks for the live show. And we will not be back until the 15th, I think it is, of July. Is that the 15th? Yeah, 15th. Mike Negoda, a good friend, he is another musical legend. Before his own time. Mike Negoda, he is from Toronto, Canada. He's going to be coming back on in August. It's going to be lovely. And I know people want to know, hey, when is Robert going to have his next celebrity interview, and who is it? If only you knew. No, just kidding, folks. You'll have to tune in and wait and see. That's all I can tell you. I've interviewed some of the best of them, folks, and I've truly enjoyed it, as well as our guest today, Michael Cagle. He's got a lot of stuff going on in his life, newly married man, and so I support him. I support his husband in the endeavors in life that they do, and of course their music shows that they do. So You Think You Can Sing? Sing! You know, I can sing out of a bucket with a hole in it. Anyway, folks, you guys don't want to hear that, right? Right? All right, folks. In the interim, you guys have a fantastic week for what's left of it. On behalf of the Robert Christian Show, so long. Be good to yourself. We'll see you next time.